Okay.
Yep.
Okay, so first of all, I want to thank the organizers for inviting me to this nice conference. And also, I have to thank, of course, all my collaborators whose results I stole to paint this picture of the QCD equation of state at finite density. And basically, I'm trying to go through what we know and what we don't know and how we want to find out about it. And so I'm going to start really modest here. So I'm going to start with what is actually the goal, or what is the legacy of high energy nuclear physics or heavy ion physics? And of course, it's not what I show here, because what I show here is actually the phase diagram of hydrogen, right? Something that people actually know. It's not very high. So for us, it's not high temperature. For us, it's also not high density, but it kind of is a good example of what we want to also have for the QCD interaction or for the strong interaction. And so when I talk about a phase diagram, I basically talk about a diagram which shows the properties and the phases of matter as function of temperature and as function of density, and in our case, the baryon density. And one thing which is interesting here, for example, in this phase diagram, you would see these gray mixed phases with first order phase transitions and also critical points. All these things we also hope to see in the QCD phase diagram. But what you also see is here, for example, lines of constant pressure, like these isobaric lines. So if we could find out all these things for the QCD phase diagram and draw a diagram like here on the right-hand side, which is just taken from a model, so this is what we think it could look like, then we would be very happy. We could print it in a textbook and everybody could look at it. So again, here, what we want to see is as function of temperature and baryon density, where does the nuclear liquid gas or nuclear matter ends? Where does the hadron matter end in turn to some deconfined quark gluon plasma? And is there a phase transition and a critical point and so on? So what are really the constraints that we have at the moment? So there are some, at the moment, I would say robust constraints on the equation of state or the type of matter of QCD from so-called lattice QCD calculations. That's where you basically discretize the QCD Lagrangian and put it on a computational lattice and then basically solve it brute force. And there we have results basically for temperatures above 130 MeV. And what is shown here on the right-hand side is essentially the what's called interaction measure. So it's the energy density minus 3 times the pressure over T to the fourth. This is a unitless quantity. And you can see how it goes up and down. So it has a maximum at some temperature. And once you have this, you can basically calculate all the thermodynamic quantities. You can calculate pressure, energy density, entropy density, and so on. Okay, so we have this. But what we also have is the derivatives of this pressure with respect to the chemical, biochemical potential. So that's one good thing. So that means we can do an expansion into the finite real chemical potential, but we also have calculations at imaginary chemical potential. And in the next slide, we will see why this is interesting. Because again, going back, we cannot solve lattice QCD explicitly for finite density. We can only do the expansion either in real or in imaginary chemical potential. So what can we do? For example, if we, let's say, want to do an expansion in the imaginary chemical potential of the QCD thermodynamics at zero chemical potential, we can use the Fourier coefficients BK from some imaginary mu B simulation as input. Okay, what you do, you can basically write the density of QCD as a cluster expansion. So this is your baryon density over T to the third, and you can write it as a sum over these functions with some coefficients. So you write it as a function of mu b over t, but remember always this is an imaginary chemical potential. So what you can also assume that you want to get to the proper Stefan Boltzmann limit at infinite temperature. And then you only basically need the first two coefficients of this series, and you can relate any higher order coefficients to these first two. You get this alpha k, which you get from the Stefan Boltzmann limit. And then you can use this to predict the finite chemical potential thermodynamics. So this was done. And here what you see is basically the results. So these purple and green lines are the lattice QCD calculations for the susceptibilities, which are the coefficients in the real chemical potential. DARs are the results from this expansion in imaginary chemical potentials. And you see that for the lower orders, they agree very nicely. And
yeah, would be useful.
And sorry?
Yep, bring it.
Okay. And if you...
Then I can give it to my dad on weekend.
Somebody's...
Sorry, yeah, I will need this.
And basically what you can do, what you cannot do easily on the lattice is basically going to higher order of these real coefficients. But once you have these imaginary coefficients to any order, you can basically just calculate them, right? So they basically come out for free. And this was done. And so we had a basically prediction of any order of chemical potential in real chemical potential. And then you put this into your Taylor series at zero chemical potential. And then what you get is that you have a finite radius of convergence of your thermodynamics around mu equals zero. And this radius of convergence basically tells us that mu b over t must be smaller than pi. So why pi? Well, okay, this is another story, but we know that once you go along the imaginary direction at mu b over t equals pi, you get a discontinuity, you get a phase transition there, and that basically sets your radius of convergence. With other words, if you want to use lattice data to do an expansion at finite mu, you will always be limited to areas where your chemical potential over temperature is smaller than pi. There's nothing you can really do about it. And so again, instead of using this method, you could also just in brute force calculate the real chemical potential derivatives and then do a Taylor expansion in real chemical potential. Okay, so then you have a different expansion, you have different coefficients, these are these chis. And if you do this, okay, then you see also, okay, it works fine. If your mu b over t is small, you can nicely expand your density as function of mu b and over t. You can do it if mu b over t equals 2, you also get some reasonable results. So stuff kind of starts to converge, but as soon as you get to mu b over t equals to 2.5, you see in blue these kind of artifacts appearing, because blue means you go to the sixth order in the coefficient, and then you see, okay, something breaks down, or your series doesn't really converge anymore. And in this paper, what they did is also another study. They also tried to independently estimate the radius of convergence, and what they also saw is that, okay, as a function of temperature, this is basically an upper a lower limit for the estimator. So they see also, well, okay, around 2 or 3, our series breaks down. Yeah, and that means, okay, we cannot really go beyond that point. That doesn't mean that there's a phase transition at this point. It just means that our series breaks down. Another interesting thing is what you see here is also that for all these expansion, always degree and the blue lines start to agree rather quickly above, let's say, 200 MeV, which means that the fourth and sixth order expansion term in UB are identical. And this is something which is essentially true if you think of the Stefan-Boltzmann limit, where you only have a term of chemical potential to the second and fourth power and no higher order terms. So this also kind of tells you that, well, it seems like above 200 MeV, you quickly reach a system which resembles that of a non-interacting system of quarks. Or it's, at least it looks like it. So the question now is, so why is there always this breakdown at mu b over t equal to 3? Okay, so is there some special reason for this? Is this just by chance? And to look at this, what I plotted here is from a very simple model, which just has, you know, hadronic particles and quarks at very high temperature and density. I plotted isobaric lines, so lines of constant pressure as function of density and temperature. And I plotted also the line in this model, which corresponds to mu b over t equals, let's say, 3. And what you can see here, that this line goes exactly along this point where all the lines go from horizontally to vertically. Right. So what does that mean? That means that there's this sudden change of the isobaric lines at this point, and that's the transition from a bosonic or mesonic or gluon dominated matter to a fermionic dominated matter, or nucleons and quarks. And that's really what's happening here, why the lattice breaks down, why this description breaks down, because it's very good at describing the bosonic matter, but it's not very good at describing fermionic matter. And that's also why you have the fermionic sign problem. So these all these first principle calculations seem to really fail once you go from the meson and quark and gluon dominated matter to matter which is dominated by nucleons and quarks, right? So you cannot really use it anymore. So what can we do then, right? We want to know the whole phase diagram. We don't only just want to know the t equals zero, the mu equals zero line. So what we have here is over here we have some guidance from measured neutron star masses. Okay, so what does that mean? So in as we heard already yesterday, what people measure in astrophysics is they measure, try to measure the mass and the radius of neutron stars. But if you only measure one of them, you don't really have much of a constraint, as you can see here. You see, you have a lot of models. They can all have the same mass, but they have very, very different radii. And as at the same time, with one radii, you also can have different masses. So as long as you don't have both, you don't really have a constraint on your equation of state. However, what you can do, you can, for example, add some constraint for the high density physics. So you have PQCD calculation at very high energy density and zero temperature, and you have neutron matter or nuclear matter at very low. And then you kind of try to interpolate between these two and try to describe on the at the same time constraints from mass observations. On top of that, there are a few observations where you actually have simultaneously the mass and the radius of a neutron star. And then what people did, they try to do statistical analyses on find out what is the most likely equation of state. And it turns out, well, this blue line is the result here. And it kind of goes through this green band. So we have at least some idea of what the equation of state for t equals zero in high density is, even though there are some error bars still. And it only goes up to the maximum density of a neutron star, which is about 10 times nuclear saturation density. So what do we have? I made this little sketch. So we have the mu equals zero line. We have the t equals zero line fixed. We can do some expansion to finite mu. But what is really missing is this little block down around here for temperatures, let's say, below 150 MeV and densities above one saturation density. And that's really the interesting part we want to know. So now let's look at another phase diagram. So this is, again, everybody seems to draw their own favorite phase diagram. This is taken from the NICA website, because everybody, of course, puts their experiment exactly where the interesting part is, which is, again, this area, which I just highlighted. So this is where NICA will measure. This is also where FAIR will measure, or GSI, and where the beam energy scan will measure. And now the question is really, let's estimate the densities expected for central heavy ion collisions at these beam energies and how to do it. Well, actually, there's different models. You can start with something very simple. You just assume these nuclei, they just overlap, and that's whatever density you get. You can run sophisticated transport models and then include potentials, nuclear potentials, and so on, and then just average the densities in the box for that system. And then you can compare, and that should give you some good estimate on the expected compression you would get for these heavy ion experiments. And that's what you get. So as a function of the square root of S for these collisions, this is basically the band basically shows you the band of uncertainty of the maximum baryon density reached in these collisions. And down here, this is the maximum energy density reached in these collisions. And if you make some crude assumptions on that, you're basically if there is a phase transition, then this would occur somewhere between, let's say, 1 and 2.5 GeV per Fermi cubed. Then you get a beam energy range of, let's say, 2.5 to 5 GeV in square root of S. So that's basically my rough estimate of where to expect the phase transition. And it's pretty much model independent. So all the models, they give you very similar results. So how to study it? Now, let's say we have our experiments which can reach these energies. We have our heavy ions, we collide them. So how to look for the phase transition? And there one has to say that much of what we think about these hadronic observables at least is motivated by a fluid dynamic picture of heavy ion collisions. And this fluid dynamical picture of heavy ion collisions is actually not so complicated. It just means we have some initial state where, you know, nuclei just making contact, they are colliding, the energy is deposited, then the energy is quickly equilibrated into some thermal system. Once it's equilibrated, it can do the hydrodynamic evolution. So it expands according to the conservation equations and some equation of state. And then once it gets very dilute, particles start to freeze out and fly to the detector. So that's the picture. Of course, so then people thought about what to look at. And I'm just going to present one example for a observer which was said to be very sensitive to the equation of state, and that's the so-called directed flow, or V1. And so this was already very early proposed as a signal for the phase transition. So, and at that time, people were basically doing only one or two fluid dynamics throughout the whole evolution, no non-equilibrium, no final state rescattering. And the idea is that basically the nuclei, they collide. And as you have seen in Mike Lisa's talk, you get basically momentum anisotropies. And then part of the matter goes a little bit into a positive x direction, and the other way, of course, because you conserve momentum, it goes into the other x direction. And then you get, if you then calculate the average x over z momentum in the forward hemisphere and the backward hemisphere, you get a different sign, and then you can calculate the derivative of the px, and then you can plot it as function of beam energy. And what people saw is that if you have a phase transition, this thing always kind of drops below zero. And then they said, okay, this is a clear sign for the phase transition. And then, so what then STAR actually measured is this, exactly this derivative. So this dV1 dy at y equals zero. And they saw for proton, it actually goes below zero and then goes back up to zero, right? The problem is now, until now, we have not a single model simulation which can actually reproduce this. And so this was a paper where we tried to reproduce this using fluid dynamics, and it really never worked. And also the details of this V1 seem to be very sensitive on what happens in this very early pre-equilibrium stage before you start your hydrodynamics. And that's what is shown here. So basically here, the V1 as a function of Y for two different simulations, one where the initial state is done in a different way, and you can see how the slope changes very rapidly. So basically what this means, that V1 is very sensitive to the softness of the initial state, which is not described by the hydrodynamic picture, right? At least in the standard hydro model we have nowadays. So what people then did is, of course, they said, okay, I don't really trust the hydrodynamics at these low energies, so I will just put in my equation of state into a full transport simulation. And then again, one saw again this little dip in the V1, right? But again, this all depends a little bit also then on model properties. So that was the one signal. Another thing what people want to look at is fluctuations. And that's basically because, well, we know that if we calculate basically the correlation length of a system, of a thermal system, when we get close to either the spinodal lines of a phase transition or the critical point, then the correlation length diverges, which means that you get clusters, that you get strong fluctuations. And you get phase separation. So this should show up in the fluctuations of the system, right? So you should measure higher orders of the fluctuation measurements, and then you should see the phase transition. But one thing you always should remember, first of all, this is all these thermodynamic considerations are all in coordinate space, and you always have to think about how to translate this into the measured momentum space. And it's always never the amplitude of the density fluctuation which diverges, it's the correlation length. So this is something which is very difficult to then transfer into a real observable. So this was done, it was tried, and what is plotted here is the so-called skewness, which is basically the third order cumulant of the net proton number distribution function in a model. And what we show here is two cases, one which has a phase transition with fluctuations and one which doesn't. So that's basically the difference between the red and the black line. And you do see that there at a beam energy where you have the phase transition, there is some enhancement, but it's actually not as big as you would think. So, or as people would hope, because actually there's a lot of other ambiguities in this. And if you look at how is the data, so here again, this is the same observable from measured by the STAR data. Well, what they see here is something which goes up and then has a very big error bar at a low beam energies where you expect the phase transition. And the same is true also for the even higher order cumulant. Yeah, you see here at this lowest energy where you get the closest to where you would expect the phase transition, you get a huge error bar. and it's not clear whether this is consistent with just nothing happening or something really exciting happening. And this is really where you need a lot of statistics. Okay. So in short, what is really measured are fluctuations and correlations in momentum space. And that is true for almost every high and every observable that should be sensitive to the phase transition. And the downside of hadrons is always that freeze out and rescattering wash out the signal because your hydrodynamic evolution ends. And then your particles start to rescatter and decay. And that kind of washes out a lot of correlations. And of course, what you want is some kind of implementation of the equation of state for a fully dynamical description from pre-equilibrium to freeze out. And that actually is something which hasn't been really achieved yet. And that brings me to my last point. And so what I show here is a really highly sophisticated depiction of what people thought happens in heavy ion collision, or people still think. Basically, you create a very hot soup of stuff, and this hot soup then cooks new particles, and these particles then fly away. And this was the idea in the early days where how strangers would be produced, and then later people found out, well, okay, but strange particles can be described very well by the thermal model picture, which is just defined on some freeze-out hypersurface, so somehow this picture doesn't really help here. However, where it helps, if you look at electromagnetic probes, because electromagnetic probes, meaning electrons, positrons, they are emitted throughout the whole evolution and they don't have any hypersurface, they don't do any rescattering, and they can be measured directly in the direct probe of the dense system. So what we try to do here is, or what we see here is basically the time integrated four volume of two different systems. It's actually the same beam energy, but with two different equation of state. On the right hand side, you have the phase transition. So you see basically that you have two clumps of matter, which are the two coexisting phases. So the system spends a lot of time in the dense phase. And then after some time, it decays in the low density phase, while in the case without the phase transition, it just expands continuously as function of time. Now, you don't have to really fully understand what all these figures, but what you do have to see is that they look different, right? And the funny thing is now, if you now try to calculate the electron positron emission from these two different results, you see that they are also quite different. And that is shown here, and that is really a new result. I'm kind of preparing the manuscript right now. What you see here is basically the spectra of the electron positron pair emission when you have two different equations of state. And it's better to see the difference when you look at the right-hand side. So the black line is basically the ratio between the hydrodynamics with phase transition over the hydrodynamics without a phase transition. And you can see that you basically get a factor two enhancement for dileptons with masses up to, let's say, 1 GeV. And this is actually quite big signal compared to most things that you see in the hadronic sector. So this is actually something which is quite exciting. So what can be done? So how can we go further from here? So the idea really is we have to design effective models that match lattice QCD at low chemical potential and neutron star properties at high density, employ these models for heavy ion collision as well as neutron star mergers to find a consistent description of both, and then possibly also use new analysis methods that combine many observables and statistical machine learning methods to actually confirm that whatever model we cooked up describes all these different types of data. That's probably the only way we can hope to achieve any clarity on the phase diagram. One of these examples, for example, would be some effective chiral mean field model based on the symmetries of QCD. We have to describe nuclear matter using also describing lattice phenomenology, but also include deconfinement of quarks and gluons via some effective potential. And then what you have to do, you just take your model, you fit your parameters of the model to the lattice data, like so. You also try to fit your hadronic interactions and quark interactions to describe the higher order derivatives of the lattice data, like so. Right? And once you've done this, you can see, well, I can extend my model to finite temperature, and this is a very messy plot, I understand, but basically what you have to think about is that dark blue means there's a phase transition and red means it's a very stiff equation of state. So what this model now tells us is if we fit it all to the lattice data, we describe neutron star properties, we only get our little phase transition here, which is nothing else but the nuclear liquid gas transition, and we get another tiny phase transition down here with a critical endpoint, which is of the order of 20 MeV, and besides that, we only get all kind of crossover transitions in over the whole phase diagram. So this would be one example. Now, what is missing is, of course, we have to now take this equation of state and try to make it, see if it's consistent with all these observables which are floating around, which I talked to you about, right? And what you also now can do is you can use this equation of state to put it into the simulation of neutron star mergers and try to treat heavy ion collisions and neutron star mergers on the same footing. And the funny thing is that if you want to check out what are the phases or the regions of the phase diagram which are scanned by neutron star mergers and heavy ion collisions, you can see that they are actually quite similar. So the lines here would be expansion trajectories for hydrodynamic evolutions of heavy ion collisions, where all the points here are actually points in the evolution of a neutron star merger. So they overlap strongly. And that means that we actually probe the same densities and temperatures. And that means that there is an extra consistency check which we can do. And that's basically again shown here. So this would be then a simulation of neutron star mergers, which we want to do with the same equation of state, and then see whether the observables come out also right in this case. Okay, so to summarize, that was a lot of stuff, but I think I hope to have convinced you that lattice QCD seems to be only useful up to chemical potentials over temperature about 3. After that, fermions become the dominant degrees of freedom and you have to find other methods. The neutron star properties constrain only T equals 0 up to a certain density. We don't have any sign of a critical point or phase transition yet, either in lattice QCD nor in experimental data. And what we really have to do is we have to combine complex models and to really try to describe the matter at low energy, heavy ion collisions and neutron star mergers together, and then take all these constraints seriously and try to really constrain our equation of state. Okay, so and I'm going to finish here because I think it's already late.
Okay, thank you very much, Jan, for this impressive talk. Questions to Jan? There will likely be a short delay. We have just a few minutes for questions. I don't see it right now. So may I ask you a question regarding the fluctuation analysis?
Yes.
So when people look at the fluctuations of high orders, like fourth to second or sixth to second, I'm just curious, those calculations usually take into account from theory, basically we expect that those are the basically will be driven by the correlation length, and because of that, the sign change is a signature of the criticality. But
I don't think that's true. So I think this idea that the sign, you mean the C6 over C2?
Yeah, I mean C4 over C2.
That's not, no, actually, you can also have this sign change if you just have a crossover. I think there's no, I mean, really it's model dependent. I would have to check. But of course, there are other things which change the amplitude of this thing, right? Like just conservation laws and so on. So all these susceptibilities are calculated either on lattice QCD or with effective models, which are basically in the grand canonical limit. So you have infinite systems, no conservation laws and so on. And in reality, you have a lot of conservation laws. You have a lot of effects from the detector. You have all kinds of stuff which you have to correct for. And so comparing this directly is very difficult. That's also why having actually a dynamical simulation, which includes some kind of effects of phase transitions is, I would say, really still important to make these comparisons.
Yeah, okay, because I was about to ask how to deal with finite sizes and
times. Yeah, this is really a big issue still. I mean,
probably the last question from my side. As a sign of the first order phase transition, so what is seen from the model that basically is either in a different place or basically models show that there will be no deep or any specific structure. How one can try to resolve this?
Yeah, that's what I tried to say. So in the end, of course, if you have a phase transition which is super weak and has a very small latent heat, you probably won't be able to distinguish it from a crossover, because then the difference is too small. But what you can do is, if you have a very strong phase transition, as I said, there are different observables which are differently sensitive on these phase transitions. And what you have to find is, it's not enough just to find one observable, I think, because this you can always describe in a different way. But if you have several observables which all are consistent with having, let's say, a strong phase transition, then this is kind of a clear signal.
Excuse me, can I ask you a short question? Do you hear me? Can I ask a short question? Do you have limit of thermalization in your model? Is it applicable at very low energies?
So, okay, there's several models. Okay, there's actually, as I said, let's go a little bit back. So this is what is used at very high beam energies, where you have basically your pre-equilibrium, then you assume very quick equilibration or thermalization, and then you assume some freeze out. This is probably not going to work at the very lowest beam energies, where this pre-equilibrium or equilibration phase actually takes quite some time and it overlaps a lot with the hydrodynamic evolution. So you have some parts of the system which might already be in equilibrium and other parts which will never reach it. So I think also the modeling at lower beam energies requires a little bit more than this. Interestingly, there are models which are even simpler, like just pure one fluid or three fluid hydrodynamic simulations, which also do a pretty good job at describing the dynamics at low energy. So somehow the idea of total local equilibration is not really, seems to be not super relevant. You just have to make a consistent description, and which is good, but also requires a little bit of understanding.
Okay, thank you.
Jan, this is Kirill Bugayev. May I make a comment? You see, what I think, thanks for nice talk, but still I think that one thing is missing. I should remind you that we have small systems in our laboratories. So in particular in collisions, we cannot see phase transitions. Yes. And there are, I don't know, 100,000 of particles only, and then you cannot go to thermodynamic limit. So one thing which is, I believe, is very important and which is missing in your talk is that we should really work on the thermodynamics and statistical mechanics, in particular creation of state of finite systems. Then probably we will have a chance to see some imprints of or signals of phase transformation. You see, I'm working in the nuclear liquid gas phase transition for 30 years. Until now, we're debating whether it is a phase transition or it is not a phase transition. So, and there the signals are much more clearer. Physics is much simpler than what we have at high energy collisions. Okay, so this is my comment. Please take it seriously.
I completely agree. I think absolutely. I just was trying to paint a little bit of a optimistic picture, but yes, you're right. Of course, you have to consider all the fact that your system is finite, that your system has a finite lifetime, and so on. Right? So there's many things. And, but I would add, maybe there's another possible way of doing it. Of course, if you were able to have a microscopic description which has some interactions which are able to describe this, which you can also do for the nuclear liquid gas transition, this might also be but it's difficult to include a change of degrees of freedom in this, such kind of a microscopic description. But that is also some venue I think one should try.
Sorry for interrupting. Unfortunately, we have to
stop the
discussions, unfortunately, but because the next session will start here.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you everyone for joining this plenary sessions. Then we can go switch to the parallel sessions.